moment, quiet light, morning star, so strong and bright, gentle mother, peaceful dove, teach us wisdom, teach us love. Blessed are you among women, blessed in turn all women too. Blessed quiet light, morning star, so strong and bright, gentle mother, peaceful dove, teach us wisdom, teach us love, teach us wisdom.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. And welcome to St. Philip Neri Parish, everyone, today on this fifth Sunday of Easter. Do we have anyone visiting us from out of town today? Anyone visiting us? Where from? Grand Rapids with us. Grand Rapids. Do you know each other? No. Okay. Well, you'll meet each other after Mass. Okay. Where else? Owasso, good to have you. Anyone else visiting? Okay, well, thank you all for coming to Mass today. Why don't we go to our special prayer now and pray together. My parish is composed of people like me. I help make it what it is. It'll be friendly if I am. It'll be holy if I am. Its pews will be filled if I help fill them. It will do great work if I work. It'll be prayerful if I pray. It'll make generous gifts to many causes if I am a generous giver. It'll bring others into worship if I invite and bring them. It'll be a parish of loyalty and love, of fearlessness and faith, of compassion, charity, and mercy, if I who make it what it is am filled with these same things. Therefore, with the help of God, I now dedicate myself to the task of being all things that I want my parish to be. Amen. And also on this fifth Sunday of Easter, we have something special happening immediately after Mass. We are going to go out to the Marian Shrine here in the back, and we're going to have the May crowning of our Blessed Mother. And I hope that many of you can come back for that special time today as we honor our Blessed Mother today as we begin this month of May dedicated to her. Okay, let's take a moment for sacred silence as we center our hearts on the mystery we're about to celebrate.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Philip Neri. Let us stand and celebrate the fifth Sunday of Easter.
Thank you.
Sisters and brothers, today as we gather here, the image of the gospel is the vine and the branches. We all connected to that main vine, Jesus, who he calls all of us to bear much fruit for him. For those times that we fail him, those times we sin and do not bear that fruit, let's ask the Lord today for his mercy and the forgiveness of our sins. You came to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call all of us sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And you plead for each one of us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life that is everlasting.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father,
Father. Amen.
Glory to God.
Almighty and ever-living God, constantly accomplish the Paschal mystery within us, that those you have pleased to make new in holy baptism may under your protective care bear much fruit and come to the joys of life eternal. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Saul arrived in Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were afraid of him, not believing that he was a disciple. Then Barnabas took charge of him and brought him to the apostles, and he reported to them how he had seen the Lord and that he had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had spoken out boldly in the name of Jesus. He moved about freely with them in Jerusalem and spoke out boldly in the name of the Lord. He also spoke and debated with the Hellenists, but they tried to kill him. When they learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him on his way to Tarsus. The church throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria was at peace. It was being built up and walked in the fear of the Lord, and with the consolation of the Holy Spirit, it grew in numbers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will praise you, Lord, in the assembly of your people.
I will praise you, Lord, in the assembly of your people.
My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and shall have their fill. They shall praise the Lord, those who seek him. May their hearts live on forever and ever.
I will praise you, Lord, in the assembly of your people. All
the earth shall remember and return to the Lord. All families of the nations worship before him. They shall worship him, all the mighty of the earth. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust.
I will praise you, Lord, within the assembly of your people.
And my soul shall live for him, my descendants shall serve him. They shall tell of the Lord to generations yet to come, declare his saving justice to people yet unborn. These are the things the Lord has done.
I will praise you, Lord, within the assembly of your
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and truth. Now this is how we shall know that we belong to the truth and reassure our hearts before him in whatever our hearts condemn. For God is greater than our hearts and knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence in God and receive from him whatever we ask, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this commandment and his commandment is this: we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Those who keep his commandments remain in him, and he in them. And the way we know that he remains in us is from the Spirit he gave us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He takes away every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and everyone that does, he prunes so that it bears more fruit. You are already pruned because of the word I spoke to you. Remain in me as I remain in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit on its own unless it remains on the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, because without me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me will be thrown out like a branch and wither. People will gather them and throw them into the fire, and they will be burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask for whatever you want, and it will be done for you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Alleluia. For those of you that follow sports or play them, you know that there are two kinds of players. And I'm speaking about not the good ones and the bad ones. I'm thinking about something quite different. I'm thinking about the ones that are very quiet and the ones that are talkers. Some players, you know, simply go about their business on the court, the field, the ice, without hardly ever saying a word. They don't yell at the referees or the umps. They don't yell at the other team. They just do what they have to do. They don't brag before others or after a game or during the game. They just play hard and try to do as well as they can. Now, the other players, sometimes they can't stop talking. Before the game, they babble on and on about how good they are and how they're going to beat the other team, or also how wonderful they are. They tell everyone. During the game, they scream at the officials, and sometimes at the other players of the other team, and they continually get their ear of the opponent. Trash talking, at times they call it. And now some of the players are good enough to back it up. What they say and what they do is performed in this. They can fulfill their predictions and their promises that they've made. And when that happens, usually the opponents respect them because they back up their boasting by their wonderful performance. It's their performance that really garners their respect of the competition. But if someone continually runs their mouth off during a game and doesn't perform well, that's really a different story, isn't it? Especially when you give 100 excuses of what happened. In that case, the person might think you're kind of foolish, and the opponents really don't respect that person really at all. And that's kind of understandable. And when a person acts that way, we often think or say about them, well, they surely talk a good game. And of course, what's meant by that statement is that their words and their actions of that person really don't match at all. They don't match up at all. That person doesn't translate their words into their actions. And their words really, in a very sense, are very empty. Very empty. We heard today in the second reading that Kathy proclaimed for us today, children, let us not love in word or speech, but in deed and truth. Indeed and truth. St. John's, in that opening line of the reading today, reminds all of us of what's most important us who are believers. He reminds the early Christians that the story that they must tell is so wonderful, so great, that they have to tell this story. Make sure they tell it and tell it well, because it's the greatest story that was ever told. And in the incredible story, the words themselves would not be enough. It would not be enough. People would want to see something in them, a difference in them, something real in them, because of the words they spoke. It wouldn't be enough simply to speak the words. They'd have to show people that they were inspired by the Jesus who was risen, that the message that they were giving to others was real. The gospel message is the good news, is to be embraced by all who hear it, but people sometimes won't embrace it unless they see it alive. And so those first Christians, they really lived it in deed and truth. That's why they made such an impact on the people they spread the message to. That's why so many people started to believe. They saw that something beautiful in these new believers. John seems to know that, as he uses modern language, talking a good game would not be enough. Believers would have to see the produce in the field of their lives. to back up the claims they were making. And so, with tangible results, people came to the faith. They wanted to believe because they saw something different in these Christians. These Christians. Don't we often sometimes fail and fall into the trap of not sometimes backing up what we say?
Sometimes I think
we as Christians talk a good game, talk good talk, say good words, but sometimes we don't always follow through. And we know that honestly as human beings fail. I think it's painful sometimes to consider some of the things about what we're called to do as believers. We don't fall through. We can pray for people that are hungry and really want the best for those that are hurting in our world. But if we say those things and never do anything to feed the poor, to shelter the homeless, to be there for those who are desperate, what does that say? We can all talk about how important it is to forgive someone, to let go. To let go. Grudges are no good. They just pull us down and make us sad. We all can do that. But sometimes when we see people that hurt us, we bring it all back up. Like a computer screen, it's all back up there, what happened, and we don't let go. That hurts. It hurts our being. It doesn't let us go on. We can say all people are precious to God, and we know that. We know God made all of us the same. We're all beautiful in God's sight, but sometimes we so quickly judge people that are different, so different than us. We come to conclusions that probably often aren't even true because we don't even get to know the people we judge. So often, we talk how important it is to want all these wonderful things in the world to happen. So many things we want to have happen here, other places that we know are where good things happen. But sometimes our giving is not from our want. It's often from our excess, and sometimes in the things we want to support much, we don't really give all our all. And you know, I could go on and on and on about many things in life where we sometimes just don't carry through. Our motives might be wonderful, and they might be at times great, but sometimes we just talk a good game. We don't back it up. The gospel message we heard today is a very familiar one to us, especially for us that live in northern Michigan. We know how many vineyards we have. We see all those beautiful vines growing. We see the branches cut in the winter and laying on the ground, pruning away for this year's harvest ahead. We get those vines to grow better. We know that image. Jesus knew that image from his day. There were vines all over the place, great vines growing in vineyards everywhere in Israel. Jesus used this image of the vine and the branches to remind the people of how much they were connected to God, that vine, to him. He wanted to show us that that vine sustains us, keeps us living and giving, keeps us the people we need to be, connected to God. And this metaphor is summed up in that beautiful line Jesus says, "Remain in me, and I will remain in you." And that really gets at the heart of what really matters. My friends, our faith teaches us incredible things. It truly does. God gave us his Son so that we would have life. That Son died on the cross for us, to save us from our sins, to open the gates of heaven for us so that one day, because of his risen self, we would have life eternal. But there is one more thing that is just as incredible. Our God doesn't just leave us on our own, somewhere out there. He says to us, he lives in us. He lives in you. He lives in me. He's in us, providing us life. And that makes all the difference in the world when you think about it. he makes his home in us, so we truly can be his agents in this world. Sure, our faith isn't always easy to live. I know that. We human beings don't always get it right. We can't have a faith that's just about words. We need to be reminded that we have to live it. We can't rattle off words about our faith but not show others in our deeds, in our truth, that we are about it. Let's make sure today as we hear this gospel, these readings, that we also are like those early Christians, giving great examples in the choices we make that shape our lives. Let's show others how Jesus lives in us and remains in us by the things that we carry through with, by the things we do, our deeds. And no one will ever be able to say of us then that we just talk a good game. They will say about us, we live. We live our faith. It's real to us. And we truly are followers of the risen one. Can I have an amen to that? Amen. Shall we stand then and proclaim faith?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God and light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God, our Father, you are so good to us. In so many ways you sustain us and continue to bring your life to us. Bless us today now as we bring these prayers before you.
That the church may continue to make Jesus known to the world through words of hope and works of love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That world leaders may cooperate with one another in an effort to seek peace and prosperity for all, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That bishops and priests may never fail to proclaim the gospel, even in the face of adversity or trial, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our love may express itself in concrete actions of visiting the sick, feeding the hungry, and protecting the unborn. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who live in Christ and followed his commandments in this life may be part of God's harvest of souls on the last day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who have died, that they might know the peace of God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Ron Fernowski, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And for all of our parishioners today that are here, those that can't be here, all of our visitors here at St. Philip's today, and all those watching on the internet, that God will bless all of you as you continue to live your faith in Jesus. We pray to the Lord. For any intentions that you would like now to mention to the Lord, those here and those on the internet, to the Lord in silence. We pray to the Lord. God, our Father, thank you for calling us here today and giving us another beautiful day in which we can praise and thank you. Bless us in our faith journeys as we continue to try to live our lives in you daily, giving great examples to the world that we are your servants, your followers, your disciples. Answer these prayers we make today through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. As you are seated now, we welcome our ushers to accept your goodness, your sacrifices for the work of the parish. Thank you, people of God, for all that you do. Thank you.
I will be the vine, and the branches, all you who live in me will never, never die. I will be the sign, I will offer many chances, so live, oh live in me, and you shall have new. Remain in me as I remain in you. May ask what you will, ask what you will, and you shall see.
Brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice at your hands for praise and glory of his name.
O God, who by your wonder exchange of gifts have affected us in this sacrifice, and have made us partakers of the one supreme Godhead, grant, we pray, that as we come to know your truth, we make it ours by a worthy way of life. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, but above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. For the old order has passed away. A universe downcast is now renewed. An integrity of life has been restored to all of us in Jesus Christ, the risen one. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every nation exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the hymn of your glory as we now acclaim. Gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving you thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Walter Hurley, our Apostolic Administrator Bishop, all the clergy, and all the baptized people of God. Remember your servant, Ron Vernowski, who you called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in a death like his may now be one with him forever in the resurrection. Remember also all of our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face, and have mercy on us all, we pray. That with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, with Saint Philip Neri, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Command informed by divine teaching, we dare now to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's share some sign of peace with each other. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. And may the body and blood of Christ bring us all
to everlasting life. Amen.
I am the vine, and you are the branches, says the Lord. He who lives in me, and I in him, will bear much fruit. Alleluia. I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Lord. coming Friday, we are going to start something special here at St. Philip and for St. Louis as well. We're going to have a First Friday adoration at 11 o'clock with confession, and then new mass on First Friday here, followed by soup and sandwich luncheon, in which we're going to be able to honor those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries. Whoever would like to celebrate, we'll have birthday cake there. It would be wonderful. So a way to honor everyone once a month on First Friday. So know you're welcome. It's nice to know how they're coming, so the silence is back, a way for the church to find that they're coming. And also we're excited to let you all know that our first communion celebration is coming up in confirmation on May 23rd at the 10 o'clock mass. I get to be bishop this year for all of kids because the bishop isn't coming around because of COVID this time. And so that's happening that day. And we have 9 candidates. You see their photos in the session pillar. Look at the kids and the adults that are meeting for them and keep them in your place. Okay. And lastly, look at it, and there you are, celebrating his birthday this week, his little birthday. And I
thanks be to God, alleluia, alleluia.